So let's try to finish up on Othello today. Essentially, we've been looking at the weird forms of hybridity between classical and Christian culture that develop in the Renaissance as Shakespeare sees it. Again, these two very antithetical views of the world come together in the Renaissance. The hope was to achieve some greater synthesis. And I'm going to go back to Henry V just to remind you of what Shakespeare's hopes may have been at that time, that the point of Henry V was that you could bring together classical and Christian values, that you could bring together Christian kings and English mercuries so that we hear of Hal, King Henry V. He is as full of valor as of kindness, princely in both. That's really full of classicism and Christianity. He himself presents it as a challenge. In peace, there's nothing so becomes a man as modest stillness and humility. But when the blast of war blows in our ears, then imitate the action of the tiger, stiffen the sinews, conjure up the blood, disguise fair nature with hard-favored rage. Even Henry recognizes how problematic this is. This is like the lion and the lamb in the same person. It's like Coriolanus becoming a sweet guy for a change. And it is the challenge which Henry does rise to. But it is presented as something extraordinary in the play, something extraordinarily difficult to achieve. And Henry's positive synthesis of the warrior and the Christian gentleman is parodied in the play, as we saw, by McMorris and his great line, "So Christ save me, I will cut off your head." I want to say that Othello is a tragic counterpart to the comic McMorris, that what we're seeing in Othello is the tragic side of this hope for the great Renaissance synthesis theater, that Othello, really his mode is, "So Christ save me, I will cut off your head." That this man who is a Christian and in some degree prides himself on it, it's his way of becoming part of Venice, nevertheless keeps that barbarian in him, and ultimately that barbarian is what breaks loose, and indeed, as I'll try to show, in some ways his Christianity is so distorted that it actually makes him more barbaric. I'll keep coming back to that line in Hamlet's "to be or not to be" speech, "their currents turn awry." In some ways, this is what I'm offering you as Shakespeare's view of the Renaissance. These two great currents of classicism and Christianity come together, and in weird ways, their currents turn awry. The notion of heroism is distorted. What we're looking at in Othello is a variety of attempts to bring together these antithetical worlds. I've stressed that aspect of Desdemona. If you'll turn now to page 80, for example, this is Act 3, Scene 4, about line 151. "Beshrew me much, Amelia, I was unhandsome warrior as I am, arraigning his this unkindness with my soul." Again, warrior? It really shows you something about Desdemona, that she really is extraordinary. She is trying to be heroic. She's trying to move from the domestic to the epic world of Othello, even at the same time as Othello is trying to move from his epic world of war to the domestic, and that clash is at the heart of the tragedy of the play. And again, I've stressed so much that this play might have been a tragedy even without Iago. That what Iago says, you know, give them time, they will grow apart. There are real hints in the play that that's true, especially the "this Ludovico is a proper man" moment. A year later, they might have been in trouble even without Iago. But having said all that, And remember, I'm not trying to blame them or suggest they're responsible for their deaths or any kind of moral calculus like that. Shakespearean tragedy is not about a moral calculus. In fact, it's about the clash of different and antithetical moralities. So Shakespeare doesn't take one side or the other. But Iago is the immediate cause of this tragedy. And so we started looking at him last time, and I'm offering Iago as acting out what Nietzsche calls the slave revolt in morality. It's a remarkable anticipation of Nietzsche, as we saw in Antony and Cleopatra, but here we actually see someone take down the great-souled man of antiquity. And as I pointed out last time, the language of slave is frequently associated with Iago. Perhaps the most interesting case is on page 99, where Amelia, this is Act 4, Scene 2, about line 130, when Amelia, not knowing she's talking about her husband Iago, says, when she knows someone's poisoning Othello's mind, "I will be hanged if some eternal villain, some busy and insinuating rogue, some cozening slave to get some office have not devised this slander." And again, there's the word slave applied to Iago. And indeed, she actually gets his psychology right here, to get some office. I've emphasized that, again, Iago's evil goes beyond any normal human range. He is, in some sense, the devil. But if there's any truth to his psychology, it is what's laid out in the opening scene, the frustration of this man who's been denied an office that he thought he deserved. And to describe him, I will use the term that Nietzsche uses, ressentiment. It's basically the French word for resentment, but we have to use the French word because no people are as mean-spirited and petty as the French. And so we have to use the French word for it. That was Nietzsche's attitude towards it. I mean, basically, this word is the word we use, our word resentment. But Iago is a classic case study in what Nietzsche calls ressentiment in works like Genealogy of Morals and Beyond Good and Evil. That is, it characterizes someone who thinks the world is unfair to him, who thinks that his merit is not sufficiently rewarded, and what's worse, the lack of merit in other people is rewarded. The creature of ressentiment, as Nietzsche analyzes him, is a deeply frustrated man who feels, for example, that other men are good-looking and women are attracted to them and not to him, even though he's so much better than those merely good-looking men. When you read Nietzsche's analysis of ressentiment, it's a perfect analysis of Iago, that the man of ressentiment feels the world rewards false values and doesn't reward the true ones, and in particular looks around at the people who are successful in the world and says, "Why not me?" With a sense, I'm better than they are. For example, I'm smarter than they are. By the way, ressentiment is the root emotion of all academics, I should point out, but we won't go into those details. But it's absolutely true when academics look at the world, they keep saying, "Well, we're smarter than those guys. Why do they have all the money and all the positions of power and so on?" Iago could have been an assistant professor denied tenure. It just occurs to me that could explain the whole thing. It's essentially the situation he's in the first scene, come to think of it. Cassio's gotten tenure and Iago hasn't. Suggest that so you'll understand how this psychology works. And you really see in Iago, he is obviously a very smart and in certain ways very talented man. And you would assume he might make a good lieutenant. But the sense is he looks around. Cassio has gotten rewarded because he's handsome. Women like him. He probably was great at Venetian parties, and the women helped him advance his position, and it's his social standing. Iago is just brimful of ressentiment, and he wants to translate into action and notice, bring down Cassio, bring down Othello. And in particular, he wants to bring down the great-souled man, Othello, who is great of heart, who's worshipped by all of Venice, you know, given these great positions of authority. Iago says he's just a braggart. He's just stuffed with epithets of war. He's full of bombast. That is a certain nasty, narrow-eyed view of greatness. In a way, we're all often tempted to adopt it. We look at people who are rich and successful, and we say they're phonies. And it's very similar to what Nietzsche sees as the Christian critique of the great of the world. It's what we saw with his paltry to be Caesar in discussing Cleopatra. It is this idea, what Nietzsche calls the slave revolt morality, this Christian turn that what's regarded as good in the ancient world is really evil. And indeed, in effect, Iago's critique of Othello is that he's just proud. And Iago adds to it the fact that he's proud for no good reason. Now, again, this is the interesting aspect of the play that Alan Bloom points to, that we have no objective evidence of Othello's greatness. Now, I do believe he's a good general. And a lot of people in the play assume that. But there's no proof of it. Again, unlike Coriolanus, unlike Henry V, there are no battles we can point to that Othello even ever won. Look at page 11 again. Keep coming back to this passage. This is Act 1, Scene 2, line 18. "'Tis yet to know, which when I know that boasting is an honor I shall promulgate, I fetch my life and being from men of royal siege, and my demerits may speak unbonneted to as proud a fortune as this that I've reached." Now, at some point, you feel like saying, okay, already, produce the documents. Let's see that you fetch your life and being from men of royal siege. And notice that when I know that boasting is an honor, that's this whole paradox that we've been seeing as the classical and Christian worlds meet. Remember Henry V's line in the St. Christmas Day speech, "But if it be a sin to covet honor, I am the most offending soul alive." And as I pointed out, in Christian terms, he is the most offending soul alive because it is a sin to covet honor. And now here we see Othello saying something rather similar. "'Tis yet to know which when I know that boasting is an honor." You see the paradox there. The Christian part of him doesn't want to boast and lay claim to this honor. And so that's Iago's whole strategy. He will destroy the Othello myth. He will bring down the great souled man. And it's an incredible struggle. And I'm going to analyze it in detail because I think it's so fascinating. Again, I've said that there is a basis for what Iago does. Again, indeed, this play would lack psychological truth if Shakespeare didn't show some grounding in Othello that makes him susceptible to what Iago does. But having said all that, it's still a very difficult process. And this came up in the discussion section on Tuesday. You have to understand this play, you have to imagine what would it be like if Iago just walked up to Othello one day and said, "Your wife Desdemona is cheating on you with Cassio." Othello would probably kill him on the spot. "How dare you say that about Desdemona?" Let's take it further. He says, "Your wife is cheating on you. How do I know? I was in bed with Cassio and he let out in his sleep talking that he's having an affair with Desdemona." I mean, that is so preposterous as evidence. It would be ruled out in court on triple grounds of hearsay. Yet ultimately it works. And Iago has to prepare for that. And that's the process I now want to trace with you in some detail, because I think it's so subtle the way Shakespeare works this out. It begins on pages 60, 61 in the Signet. So Act 3, Scene 3, about line 100. As I was saying last time, it begins with Iago getting certain words in play, and especially think and honest. Is he not honest? "Honest, my lord." This is about line 105. Honest, my lord, for aught I know, what dost thou think? "Think, my lord." And even Othello says, "Think, my lord, by heaven thou echoest me, as if there were some monster in thy thought too hideous to be shown." And in a way, this is the key move. It shows that Iago is well on his way, because what he understands about the great souled man is what Iago says on page 28. So Act 1, Scene 3, line 390, the Moor is of a free and open nature that thinks men honest that but seem to be so. What, as I said last time, what Iago is going to have to do is transform Coriolanus into Hamlet here. Take a great-souled man who's not afraid of anybody and therefore doesn't worry about their secret thoughts into Hamlet, who doesn't believe a thing he sees. Seems, madam, I know not seems, as he says. And in a way, Iago has accomplished half his purpose just to get Othello to say, as if there were some monster in thy thought, to he is to be shown. Suddenly, Iago was thinking, Othello was thinking of depths, the depths of human interiority. This is the world that Christianity opened up. Thoughts about human sinfulness, for example, thoughts about hypocrisy, all those things that you don't see in the world of Coriolanus or even the world of Julius Caesar. Iago's wonderful phrasing, line 116, you know, my lord, you know I love you. And now Othello says, I think thou dost. And then, you know, this gap is starting to open up. Othello is starting to become suspicious. And then the bottom of page 61, line 125, I dare be sworn, I think that he is honest. And again, everything is twisting inward here. And nothing is as it appears to be. And so Othello says, I think so too. And Iago now says, this is the top of 62, so line 125, men should be what they seem, or those that be not, would they might seem none. Certain, Othello says, men should be what they seem. Now that was his belief. His life was based on that fact. He's a warrior. He's used to fighting on a battlefield with an objective outcome. Again, that idea that in a man-to-man combat, there's a certain objective character to the victory. And again, you don't you prove yourself in the battlefield. Othello's used to being in a world where men prove themselves in battle, and therefore what you see is what you get. But I prithee speak to me as thy thinking is, give thy worst of thoughts the worst of words. And then Iago pulls the first of his trump cards here. Line 133, good my lord, pardon me, though I am bound to every act of duty, I am not bound to that all slaves are free to. Now he identifies with slaves here. Here's the slave revolt in action. Utter my thoughts, why say they are vile and false, as where's that palace whereinto foul things sometimes intrude not? Who has that breast so pure? But some uncleanly apprehensions keep leet in law days and in session sit with meditations lawful. Again and again, he is drawing Othello to think of the depths of the human soul, something that a Coriolanus never even imagined, and that Mark Antony began to see into. And notice particularly, who has that breast so pure? Whose breasts are on Iago's Othello's mind? I mean, Iago is cleverly shifting this to Desdemona. They're talking about men here, but seems to, and again, you can talk of a man's breast. But I think that's, again, a subtle move here. And again, the notion that palace, whereinto foul things sometime intrude not. The key to what Iago succeeds in doing in these sequences is to get Othello to think there's something foul lurking within Desdemona. Not the easiest thing to do, because she is, in fact, pure. Iago subtly introduces the notion of jealousy in line 147, as I confess as my nature's plague, despite abuses, and of my jealousy, shape faults that are not. Again, Iago works by planting thoughts in people's minds. We saw it originally with Brabantio, the beast with two backs. For example, he makes Brabantio think of the most obscene image of his own daughter. And here he's It's really quite remarkable. He acts at a subconscious level. He plants these words. What he's getting at, you see on page 63, line 161, by heaven, I'll know thy thoughts. Suddenly, this great-souled man, the great general, needs something he's never needed before. He needs to see into the souls of men and women. Remember Hamlet, his need to see into the soul of Claudius when he had the chance to kill him. And because he couldn't see what thoughts were in Claudius's mind, he pulled back at that moment. And this is going to be the problem for Othello. I'll know thy thoughts. And Iago says, you cannot if my heart were in your hand. The way Iago works here is to create a deep need in Othello for something he cannot have, namely immediate insight into the soul of another human being. That ultimately is how Iago will entrap Othello to accept the flimsiest evidence in lieu of what he truly wants, namely a godlike view of what's in the soul. And then Iago, Othello has said nothing of jealousy at this point. But Iago says, well, beware, my lord, of jealousy. He gets the word on the table and then starts to, tell Othello that cuckold lives in, again, he doesn't come up and said, Othello, you're a cuckold, because he could easily be killed if he did that. But what he does, he talks in generalities about cuckold, let Othello apply the word to himself. And what we see in Othello, now again, in his reaction, line 177, why is this? Thinkst thou I'd make a life of jealousy to follow still the changes of the moon with fresh suspicions? No. To be once in doubt is to be resolved. That's not Hamlet. This is a very different man here. Indeed, again, we see the tragedy that Hamlet delays too long in killing Claudius. Othello is too precipitate in killing Desdemona. Hamlet's impulse to delay, to doubt, to reconsider things, in Othello's position, obviously, he would have delayed killing Desdemona long enough for the plot about the handkerchief to come out. But the thoughts that Iago has implanted here go deeper. And again, I don't normally go through a play this carefully, line by line, but this is dramatically the greatest scene Shakespeare ever wrote, which makes it the greatest dramatic scene ever. So line 183, 'tis not to make me jealous, to say my wife is fair, feeds well, loves company, is free of speech, sings, plays, and dances, where virtues is, these are more virtuous, nor for my own weak merits. And this is the Achilles heel of this Achilles figure, his sense that he has weak merits. Now again, this is the all-in-all sufficient Moor. This is the legend of Venice. Now admitting he has a sense of weak merits, and it's his doubts about his own inferiority that are going to poison him in the scene. Nor for my own weak merits will I draw the smallest fear or doubt of her vote, for she had eyes and chose me. Remember, I read that last time. This is so key here. That he has now staked his self-respect on Desdemona's love for him, a situation unprecedented in his life. He's a man whose self-respect presumably has been derived from the battlefield, from all his great victories, assuming that there are some. If there are none, then there might be more reasons why he's nervous here. But again, I wouldn't press that line on the play. But still, here it is. He is now resting his sense of his own worth on the fact that this woman, who could have had any man in Venice, has chosen Othello, the extravagant and wheeling stranger from here and everywhere. And so, no, Iago, I'll see before I doubt. When I doubt, prove, and on the proof there is no more but this, away at once with love or jealousy. And Iago very cleverly at line 196 says, I speak not yet of proof, because he has no proof. His strategy overall in the sequence is to create such a need for proof in Othello that he will accept the flimsiest evidence. But now Iago really goes on the offensive. This is just stunning how he maneuvers Othello here. Line 200. Look to it. I know our country disposition well. In Venice, they do let heaven see the pranks they dare not show their husbands. Their best conscience is not to leave it undone, but kept unknown. Dost thou say so? That's a terrible moment for Othello. It's a Shylock moment in that he's suddenly being told, you're not a Venetian. Iago is talking to him like some country bumpkin who has come to the Big Apple and needs to be told how people operate in a city. I know our country disposition in Venice, they do not let heaven see the pranks. Really, Iago really had to soften up Othello a lot to the point where he began speaking of his weak merits so that he can now talk to him as an outsider. And then, it's one blow after another, line 206, she did deceive her father marrying you, and when she seemed to shake inferior looks, she loved them most, and so she did. And this takes us back to that moment on page 25, which would be Act 1, Scene 3, Brabantio's farewell words to Othello, look to her more, if thou hast eyes to see, she has deceived her father, and may thee. And those words come back to haunt Othello here. Remember, that's when he said, my life upon her faith. And indeed, we will see him lose his life upon her faith. He has made so much of her faith in him. It's as if his faith in himself now rests on Desdemona's faith in him. Iago takes two steps forward and one step back. Line 225. Othello says, I do not think, but Desdemona is honest. Long live she so. And long live you to think so. Again, keeps coming back to that word think, and opening up the distinction between what merely seems and what is. Something that's all over the place in Hamlet's imagination, but was not there in Othello. And then in some ways, the most awful moment of the sequence, line 227, when Othello says, and yet how nature erring from itself. He, for a moment, now contemplates that his love with Desdemona is unnatural. This is exactly what Brabantio claimed. It's what a whole bunch of people in Venice are thinking. It is not unnatural. We've seen the greatness of this love. It's precisely the result of opposites attract. An old man and a young woman, a black man and a white woman, a non-Venetian and a Venetian woman. In every way, they're opposites, but that's what makes the love great. But for a moment here, and this is again Iago's genius, he gets Othello to adopt the standpoint of Venice, how nature erring from itself. This is custom, not nature. It's all customary ideas that make people think that this marriage is inappropriate. It's customary for a married couple to be of the same age or from the same country or from the same race. People mistake that custom for a law of human nature. But Othello now buys into it. And now Iago goes for the jugular. This is what he's been looking for this moment. And there's the point, as to be bold with you, not to affect many proposed matches of her own clime, complexion, and degree, whereto we see in all things nature tends. Foe, what may smell in such a will most rank, foul disproportions, thoughts unnatural, but pardon me, I do not in position to distinctly speak of her. I like to think of this as a stage direction. I think that Iago sees he's 1 minute away from death here. He sees something in Othello's eyes that say one more word along these lines and Iago's a dead man. Now, I've never seen it staged that way. The two movies I referred to really just gloss over this line, but I'll make the argument that this is a really dramatic moment. Iago is a lion tamer who's in the cage with the lion here. It's great in the very opera. Othello is called Il Leone, the lion. I think you can't understand how dramatic this scene is until you conceive of it. Iago is risking his life here. This is a man who's got at least three swords on him, as we learn later in the play. He is not unused to using his sword. He would not be averse to killing a man who was questioning the virtue of his wife. And Iago knows that. And again, I think at this moment, when he pulls back here, it's because he's seen he's one step from death here. Now, again, I can't prove that, but I just feel that way about the speech. I should say that in both the Willard White version and the version I saw in Washington, D.C. with Avery Brooks and Patrick Page, they had Iago at many keep a chair between himself and Othello. They're maneuvering around the stage, and I think they did understand my point. Not that I told them this, but they did picture it both in the Trevor Nunn movie and in this Washington D.C. production, that this was like lion taming. And that Iago, and I think it's a good way to conceive this scene. Iago needs to keep a chair between him and Othello because he understands that lion could come out at any moment and he would be dead. So he gets very far here, but notice he withdraws at this point. But he has raised the fundamental doubts here. And as Iago withdraws, this is the top of page 66, line 240, Othello now says, painfully, why did I marry? And go back to page 9, again to Brabantio. This is act 1, scene 1, about line 161. Who would be a father? These are the two most painful questions in the play. Both provoked by the innocent Desdemona, by the way, but Brabantio, who has to ask, who would be a father, and Othello asks, why did I marry? This is a tragedy of domestic life, and we see it here. So Iago times things perfectly. Again, two steps forward, one step back. He's really gotten where he wants Othello to be, so he pulls back, and then we see what Iago has accomplished, bottom of page 66, line 262. Happily, for I am black and have not those soft parts of conversation that chambers have, or for I am declined into the veil of years, yet that's not much, she's gone. And there you see all the self-doubts in the great souled man who is supposed to be all and all sufficient, and you know, Coriolanus doesn't stand around doubting, gee, am I nice enough to people? Why don't people like me? Maybe I shouldn't call them scabs anymore. No, that does not happen. And that's why here are the soliloquies. You know, Coriolanus, the soliloquies are kind of inert because there's nothing to examine inside himself. But here you see a man digging deep. Happily for I am black. He's worried about the racial difference. And have not those soft parts of conversation that chambers have. You know, that's Iago's problem with Cassio as well. These smooth-talking Venetians, these Bassanios, these Gratianos that always get the women. And for I am declined into the veil of years, yet that's not much. There's the Shakespearean touch. Nobody could write this speech but Shakespeare, but there's the ultimate Shakespearean touch. You know, he's worried about his age. Remember, he said to the Venetian Senate, the young affects in me defunct. this is the days before Viagra, remember. Othello's got some performance worries here, but I'm declining. Yet that's not much. That's incredible four words there, that he tries to puff himself up there. Maybe I'm too old for it. No. That's not much. But you see here all the doubts coming to the surface. And then lines I've read before on page 67, line 277. If she be false, heaven mocked itself, I'll not believe it. And again, you see this is not accomplished in one stroke. Iago has to chip away at the great souled man to cut out the feet of clay that he detects in him. Now, this, Desdemona's timing is always so bad. This is the scene we looked at in the first lecture where she comes in and reminds him about his dinner obligations. You know, the last thing he needs to hear at this moment. And this is also the moment when Desdemona loses the handkerchief, which is, in a certain technical sense, the turning point of the play, right here in the middle, Act 3, Scene 3. Notice page 69, so Act 3, Scene 3, line 318, what Iago says of this handkerchief. Trifles light as air are to the jealous confirmation strong as proofs of holy writ. And that's truly an extraordinary line that Iago is associating this talisman of marital fidelity with the Bible itself. And it does show you why faith is so important in this play as it is, for example, not in Coriolanus. Because this is a Christian world where faith in God, faith in Jesus, this has become the core of the religion. These monotheistic religions which are based on faith, unlike the ancient pagan religions, which were simply based on practices, rites, customs, where people were never catechized, they were never asked what they believe in. They manifested their religion not in an act of faith, but in acts of piety, of performing certain rituals. But one reason faith is so important in this play is that it is this Christian world where belief has become so important. Again, I could go over every single line in the scene. It is just, when you see this on the stage, it is so gripping. As so many people remark, you can barely sit there and not shout out at Othello, "The guy's a villain! Don't you understand? It's all lies." But anyway, let me skip a bit here. If we turn to page 70, where we now see the result on Othello's being in his farewell, the tranquil mind speech. This is line 344 in Act 3, Scene 3. "Oh, now forever farewell the tranquil mind, farewell content, farewell the plumed troops and the big wars that makes ambition virtue." Remember Coriolanus? 'Tis held that valor is the chiefest virtue. And here it is. This is the world Othello comes from. It's the world Coriolanus comes from. It's the world of big wars where ambition is the virtue, where your thumos manifests itself as your virtue. And this is what he's saying farewell to. By the way, this is one of the high points of the very opera. It's one of the most operatic moments in the play, and it's the great aria "Ora per sempre addio" that Othello sings at this moment. And I have to say, it's one point where Boito and Verdi outdo Shakespeare here. But you see what it is. Why in the world is he talking about war here? Why is he saying farewell the neighing steed and the shrill trump, the spirit-stirring drum? The reason is that he has invested the whole of himself in this woman Desdemona and her love for him. He can't say what, in a way, could have been his reaction here. Okay, I was mistaken. Why did I marry? Forget about Desdemona. I'm going back to war. That's where I'm a great man. That's where I prove my virtue. But he has staked everything on Desdemona's love for him, and he will lose everything. And remember, the tragedy of the love is the blending together of war and love. He was taking his bride to the battle, and she wanted to go. She wanted to become, as we've seen numerous times, a warrior. They are trying to fuse what is so normally different, war and love. I'll take you back to Henry V in his wooing scene with Catherine in Act 5, where he says, "I speak to thee, plain soldier. If thou canst love me for this, take me. If not, to say to thee that I shall die is true, but for thy love, by the Lord, no. Yet I love thee too." And I pointed out to you then how contrary that was to all the myths of romantic love. the famous "I'll die for you." And Henry's too clever for that. I mean, he's saying, you know, I love you, not enough to die for you, but I still love you. And just take me as a soldier. I'm not going to be like some French courtier that you used to, but, you know, this is a good deal. It's a good deal for you. It's a good deal for me. It's a good deal for England. It's a good deal for France. It's a very practical marriage he's proposing there, very different from what we see here in Othello, which is this, again, this absolute love that makes such demands upon love, it eventually becomes tragic and destructive here. So Othello is shaken to the depths of his soul when his identity as a warrior is mixed up in this love. He's lost. He has no retreat. He has no fallback position here. It's all or nothing now. And so this is the moment when he says, line 356, and this is a very pointed line, "Villain, be sure thou prove my love a whore." Not "villain, be sure thou determine the truth about Desdemona." No, it's specifically "prove my love a whore." What you see here is he would rather know for sure that she's a whore than remain in doubt whether she is or not. He's in a way now, he's so desperate for certainty that he will take the worst news. Indeed, he cries out for it. Be sure of it. Give me the ocular proof, or by the worth of mine eternal soul, thou hadst been better been born a dog than answer my naked wrath. And you're seeing here the strange combination of his classical heroism and his Christianity. It's not very Christian to talk about his wicked wrath. It is Christian to talk about his eternal soul. And we see the same tragic turning awry of currents that we saw in Hamlet there, where in a very Christian moment, thinking about the afterlife, he wants to damn Claudius's soul to eternal hell. And here's the problem, that he now wants ocular proof. Line 361, "Make me to see it, or at the least so prove it that the probation bear no hinge nor loop to hang a doubt on, or woe upon my life." And here, Iago quite justifiably says, "What are you doing here? I mean, I was just trying to help you. I'm just trying to be honest, and now you're threatening me with death, and you're asking me to come up with something I can't come up with." And you see Othello's dilemma, line 380. "Think my wife be honest, and think she is not. I think that thou art just, and think thou art not." He is of two minds. The great souled man is not of two minds. Again, Coriolanus is not of two minds. Coriolanus doesn't say, I think the tribunes are nasty, and I think the tribunes are noble. I think Volsces are my friends. I think, well, that's not the way the great soul man's mind works. But Iago has opened up this split in Othello. Again, the split between the way people seem to be and the way they are. No, I mean, again and again, Othello thinks like Hamlet in this scene, and especially the view of women. That women's attractive exterior conceals a sinful sexual nature that men are not aware of. And now Shakespeare's unrelenting here. The actors who play Othello, I mean, they must be exhausted by the end of the play. I don't know how anyone could endure playing the part, but my name that was as fresh as Dian's visage is now begrimed and black as mine own face. And this is a terrible moment, because Othello here has accepted the conventional view, black is evil, white is good. I mean, he's accepted the customary view in Venice that there's, you know, something, these black foreigners, there's something wrong with them. And now to use his own face as an image of what's wrong. Again, you see how Iago has undermined Othello's sense of self-worth. And, you know, it's remarkable when you read, this is a man who just exudes self-confidence. Put up your swords, for the dew will rust them. I mean, it's a man who can walk into a situation and take it over and just projects absolute confidence. Now, again, we don't know any basis for that, any real objective basis for that. And maybe that is a really interesting aspect that Shakespeare stresses here, the degree to which Othello's self-control and self-possession is a myth. But the way Iago works on it, he assumes there are chinks in Othello's armor, that this great man has feet of clay. Again, that's why I call this resentment action, why it is the slave revolt in action. It's taken down the ancient hero. It's taken down the magnanimous man, showing that he is Alexander the Pig and not Alexander the Great, as Shakespeare would have it. And now Iago really clinches it all. Othello's asking for ocular proof, and Iago shows him, you can't handle the truth. The truth, you can't. Nay, and I will, line 391. And may, but how? How satisfied, my lord, would you, the supervisor, grossly gape on, behold her top? Yeah, it's incredible. Othello's asking for ocular proof of his wife's infidelity. What does that mean? He has to see them in bed together, death and damnation. And Iago is merciless. It were a tedious difficulty, I think, to bring them to that prospect. Damn them then, if ever mortal eyes do see them bolster more than their own. What then, how now? How should I say? Where's satisfaction? It is impossible you should see this were they as prime as goats, as hot as monkeys. Turn to page 93. I mean, Shakespeare has such a... So this is Act 4, Scene 1, about line 261. Othello... has called Desdemona whore, he struck her. He exits the scene saying what? Line 263, goats and monkeys. When I talk about the way Iago operates subliminally, you see it there. Those words, prime as goats, as hot as monkeys, that just seared into Othello's mind. So that just it just explodes out later, goats and monkeys. This is a play that can seem psychologically implausible if you just narrate the plot. And again, as an exercise, just read the Cintio story in the Signet and see how bad that is and compare it to what Shakespeare made out of it. It's with details like this. And then Iago offers the proof. And notice again, this is page 72, line 405, Othello says, give me a living reason she's disloyal. Again, not tell me if she's loyal or disloyal, or prove to me what's going on here. It is, give me a living reason she's disloyal. He wants the bad news now, because the one thing he can't live with is uncertainty. Again, he's a soldier. He's used to clear-cut situations, making fast decisions on the battlefield. Here are the troops. There are the troops. We attack them there. He's not a man like Hamlet, for example, who's comfortable with living with doubt. So give me a living reason. And then Iago comes up with this spectacularly preposterous proof, which would not be admitted in any courtroom in the land. I lay with Cassio lately, and being troubled with a raging tooth, that's a great detail there, I could not sleep. They're a kind of men so loose of soul that in their sleeps will mutter them affairs. One of this kind is Cassio. In sleep I heard him say, sweet Desdemona, let us be wary, let us hide our loves. And then, sir, would he gripe and wring my hand, cry, oh, sweet creature, then kiss me hard, as if he plucked up kisses by the roots that grew upon my lips, laid his leg o'er my thigh, and sigh and kiss, and then cry, cursed fate that gave thee to the Moor. Oh, monstrous, monstrous. Nay, this was but his dream, but this denoted a foregone conclusion. And there you see it. I mean, that Othello can accept this as evidence a secondhand account of a dream. It's the flimsiest evidence imaginable, but nevertheless, Iago has made it work by creating this need for it. There's a desperate need for certainty. The one thing Othello cannot live with is uncertainty, that he will accept this evidence. And that's when we get this great speech on 73 that I read last time, the Pontic Sea epic simile. And we end with a marriage between Othello and Iago here. Again, this is a great moment in the opera. The Si Per Ciel duet between Iago and Othello. There are very few redoings of anything by Shakespeare that are worthy to be in the same room with Shakespeare, but the Verdi Boito opera of Othello is a great, great work, and this is one of the finest moments in the opera. Now, by yon marble heaven, in the due reverence of a sacred vow, I here engage my words, and Iago says, do not rise yet, and witness you ever-burning lights above, you elements that clip us round about, witness that here Iago doth give up the execution of his wit, hands, heart, to wrong at Othello's service. Let him command, and to obey shall be in me remorse, what bloody business ever, I greet thy love. And it ends with, now thou art my lieutenant, I am your own forever. And it's like a demonic parody of a marriage here, that the two warriors have lined up against Desdemona to destroy her. Now there are, you know, this does not end here, but I mean, this is... The psychological distance traveled in this scene is extraordinary. And again, it happens so quickly, but you see how, and Iago knows just where to attack, when to attack, when to withdraw. It's an extraordinary scene, and in fact has utter psychological plausibility. And again, in both those movies, Willard White and Laurence Olivier handle this scene wonderfully. The Iagos are not quite as good. Anyway, just to finish up on this, turn to Act 4 now, and here are the words again, scene 1, page 83. Will you think so? Think so, Iago. Again, you know, the great-souled hero like Cornelius doesn't think very much. He doesn't think about stuff. He doesn't have to. He gets things done, so he doesn't have to think so much about them. Hamlet thinks a lot about things, and now Othello thinks a lot about things. And that takes him out of the element, what makes him pray to Iago here. And Iago now is just in his high pornographic mode. Still page 83, line 4, or to be naked with a friend in bed an hour or more, not meaning any harm. This is almost comic here, and it's one of the extraordinary things about the play is how it teeters on the brink of comedy here. This is so ridiculous that if Othello weren't such a great man and if so much weren't at stake here, this would seem like comedy. Naked in bed, Iago, and not mean harm is hypocrisy against the devil, and so on. Bottom of page 83, so about line 15, Othello says, she is the protectress of her honor too. May she give that. Her honor is an essence that's not seen. And that's the core of Iago's strategy, the idea that what's really at stake in human life is something invisible. It was the same issue in Hamlet. It was, after all, the issue at the focal point of Hamlet when Hamlet does not kill Claudius. Claudius's soul is something unseen. As we learn, in fact, Claudius wasn't going to be saved if he died at that moment, but Hamlet cannot see that. Hamlet's need in Act 3 is to see into the depths of Claudius's soul, but that's an essence that is not seen. This is what happens when we move from the ancient world. The ancient world where what you see is what you get. And again, Hector and Achilles. Achilles doesn't care what's going on in Hector's soul when they meet on the battlefield. It's just last man standing wins. But Hamlet is in such a different situation, where what's going on in someone else's soul is what's at stake, and that you cannot see. And Iago's trick is to maneuver Othello into Hamlet's world, where the essence of human virtue is something that's unseen. Therefore, to again create this need. And indeed, this is the moment when Othello has his fit. Notice on page 84, line 36, he breaks down into prose. It's a typical moment in Shakespeare when we see the mental unhingement of a character. It's often reflected by the blank verse breaking down into prose. So it just dawned on me, suddenly Othello sounds a lot like Hamlet here in his ability to play with words. Lie with her, this is line 36 in Act 4, Scene 1. Lie with her, lie on her. We say lie on her when they belie her. Lie with her. I won't do this on the final, but if I were to give you these lines, you might guess they were Hamlet. This is more in the Hamlet mode. Othello doesn't play with words, but he does now. Handkerchief, confessions, handkerchief, to confess and be hanged for his labor, first to be hanged and then to confess. I tremble at it. Nature would not invest herself in such shadowing passion without some instruction. It is not words that shake me thus. And of course, the irony is, it is only words that shake him. There is no reality to what Iago's talking about. It is only words. But this is Iago's great triumph, that the words can shake him. And you can just imagine what Iago's feeling here. Noses, ears, and lips. What Iago has gotten to do here, gotten Othello to do, is to focus on the body. Remember his initial claim about his love for Othello had nothing to do with the body. She says, I loved Othello for his mind. He loves her for her mind. This is not a physical attraction. The young affects me defunct. And what Iago has gotten to do here is to get Othello to start thinking in sexual terms about her. And indeed, it's something we see again and again in Othello. And now he completely breaks down the top of 85. I have to say again, this is a moment where Verdi trumps Shakespeare, because at this point Iago says, Ecco il leone, behold the lion. And it psychologically is absolutely true. It's one of the few lines anyone ever outdid Shakespeare, because that's the resentiment triumphing. Behold the lion. This was the great Moor of Venice. Look at him now. He's foaming on his mouth, groveling at my feet. I did it. I reduced this man to that. It is the triumph of the slave over the master. It's the flowering, full flowering of resentment. It's an incredible moment. And again, I hate to say it, but Verdi outdoes Shakespeare. That is so psychologically true here. And of course, this is what Iago has accomplished here. He's gotten Othello to think of Desdemona as a flesh and blood woman. Now, Iago himself thinks that way. If you go back to page 38, when he's talking to Roderigo and diminishing Desdemona in his eyes, this is Act 2, Scene 1, about line 231. The wine she drinks is made of grapes. Again, I don't think any line could capture Iago's philosophy more perfectly than that. The wine she drinks is made of grapes. This is a flesh and blood woman. She's not some spiritual creature. This wine is just a physical property here. And that's what he's gotten Othello to think of. Look at page 76. Again, these scenes between Othello and Desdemona are almost too painful to read or watch. But so Act 3, Scene 4, line 36, give me your hand, this hand is moist. What a discovery that you marry a living woman. Her hand is not made of alabaster, as he hopes later in the play. We say a man puts a woman on a pedestal. Othello put Desdemona on a pedestal. He imagined her as this perfect statue. And now he touches her hand, and he realizes this is a flesh and blood woman, and therefore sinful. And what does he say? He says, "Get thee to a nunnery." Line 37. This argues fruitfulness and liberal heart, hot, hot and moist. This hand of yours requires a sequester from liberty, fasting and prayer, much castigation, exercise devout, for here's a young and sweating devil here that commonly rebels. 'Tis a good hand, a frank one. And again, this is Iago has turned Othello into Hamlet here. This is just like the get thee to a nunnery scene. You're a woman, you're flesh and blood, that means you're sinful, and you need a sequester from liberty. You need to be in a nunnery, fasting and prayer, much castigation. And this, again, we see here the same problem we saw in Hamlet, that he cannot accept a fellow human being, and especially a woman, in human terms. He wants an angel, and if he doesn't have an angel, he thinks he has a whore. He cannot find a middle ground here, which is where human life occurs. It's especially where marriage occurs. The middle ground between two human beings where they have to make compromises and accept their weaknesses and accept their problems. But no, he wanted an angel. I mean, the irony is he pretty much got an angel. But even Desdemona's hand is moist. And so this leads to the really tragic resolution here where everything that's worked for Othello now works against him. Page 90, where... is that right? Page 90, Act 4, Scene 1, about line 205. Give me some poison, Iago, this night. I'll not expostulate with her, lest her body and beauty unprovide my mind again. Now, again, I'll remind you what he said to the Senate. Keep coming back to these things. When he told them, this is back on page 23, Act 1, Scene 3, when he wants Desdemona to accompany him to Cyprus, line 256, vouch for me, heaven, I therefore beg it not, to please the palate of my appetite, nor to comply with heat, the young effects in me defunct, and proper satisfaction, but to be free and bounteous to her mind. You know, there's no body involved here, according to Othello. But now... You know, we may presume that he was sexually attracted to Desdemona, who is presented as the most sexually attractive object in Venice here. And here, bottom of page 90, I'll not expostulate her, lest her body and beauty unprovide my mind again. Or page 97, when he is confronted with her. This is actually start at the bottom of 96. So Act 4, Scene 2, line 66. O thou weed, who art so lovely fair and smells so sweet that the sense aches at thee. You know, he denied her sensuality before the Senate. But now he admits to it. I hear an echo in this of Shakespeare's sonnet, the famous sonnet 94, lilies that fester smell far worse than weeds. This notion of Desdemona as a weed here. So it's a very difficult moment for him here. And he now can only think of killing her. And it's acted out in a very frightening way. It's on page 114, starting, so Act 5, Scene 2. Again, we see how his Christianity gets involved in making it worse. That's what's so tragic about this scene. He's doing something very unchristian. He's murdering. Even more so, he's murdering out of a sense of revenge. And yet he wants to present it now as if it were a Christian act. Look at the opening of Act 5, Scene 2, so on page 114. It is the cause. It is the cause, my soul. Here he is addressing his own soul, and he does need a cause to do this. Let me not name it to you, you chaste stars. It is the cause. Yet I'll not shed her blood, nor scar that whiter skin of hers than snow and smooth as monumental alabaster. Yet she must die. People have pointed out, and Othello is a magnificent speaker, and we get that to be light to the Pontic Sea. He speaks in such glorious blank verse. We see the disruption of his mind when he descends into prose and just spouts out words, noses, lips, goats and monkeys. He has recovered what G. Wilson Knight calls the Othello music here. Again, this is that glorious blank verse that he speaks. And notice he's trying to present it as now a spiritual act. I'll not shed her blood. It won't be murder if I don't shed her blood. He's going to stifle her with a pillow instead. But notice the whole idea here again is whiter skin of hers than snow and smooth as monumental alabaster. That's the way he wants to conceive of her. This is his sense of her purity, that she's not a woman of flesh and blood, that she is like a statue. And yet he can't stop kissing her in this scene, and you can see that the mixture of sensuality is there. And then line 21, this sorrow's heavenly, it strikes where it doth love. That there's something of a crusade in this, that he will kill her for her own good. This sorrow's heavenly, it strikes where it doth love. I'll remind you of a line from Antony and Cleopatra, let him that loves me strike me dead. I offered that towards the end of that play as one of the paradoxes that starts to emerge in late antiquity as we move towards a Christian world. Let him that loves me strikes me dead. And here it is, that sorrow's heavenly, it strikes where it doth. And so we get a very complex interplay between Othello and Desdemona in the scene. And it's so painful because we realize her life is at stake and his life is at stake. He's about to do the most awful thing he could possibly do. And yet he keeps trying to do it in this perversely Christian way. So look at the top of page 115. Have you prayed tonight, Desdemona? Aye, my lord. If you bethink yourself of any crime, unreconciled as yet to heaven and grace, solicit for it straight. This is the opposite of Hamlet now. Remember, Hamlet with Claudius. Hamlet who wanted to kill Claudius when he wasn't absolved, when he was fresh in his sins. Othello has become a kind of priest here who will confess her and make sure her soul is pure. As he says in line 31, I would not kill thy unprepared spirit. No heavens forfend, I would not kill thy soul. Hamlet would kill Claudius's soul. So the infinite complication of bringing together any kind of revenge ethic with a Christian sense that revenge is evil and that beyond that, the eternal state of the soul is at stake. And once again, poor Desdemona, in her honest reactions, keeps saying the worst things. I feel like thinking if she had just confessed something now, it would have taken the wind out of Othello's sails. But, you know, he think on thy sins, line 30, line 40, they are loves I bear you. And for that thou diest. By her own protestations of innocence here, and remember, he is now absolutely convinced she's guilty, he won't believe her. Remember, and again, I forgot to mention this, yeah. Remember, the absolute proof for Othello is that moment when Iago makes Othello think he's overhearing Cassio confess his sins with Desdemona, and especially gets Cassio to laugh. Cassio is in fact talking about Bianca, but Othello overhears it. Again, the two movies stage this pretty well, that he has reason to think he's hearing what in fact he's not hearing. And again, you see, Iago's genius is to make Othello see the world through Iago's eyes. Othello, that's as close to ocular proof as he ever gets. He thinks he's hearing Cassio confess. He's absolutely certain of it in this scene. And yet, of course, it is just a completely contrived scene where Othello is not, in fact, hearing what he thinks he's hearing. Here, he still on page 116, he stresses everything on the issue of confession. And notice line 64 on page 116, and makes me call what I intend to do a murder which I thought a sacrifice. Again, the real perversity of this scene, again, the current turning awry, is the idea that what is in fact a brutal murder, he tries to present as an almost religious rite here. And then everything you might notice turns on confession here. Desdemona asks, you know, let him confess the truth. And Othello says he hath confessed. Again, he's been completely taken in by Iago then. And I think the force of the scene is best encapsulated in line 86. I that am cruel am yet merciful. And that, you know, that sums up everything that's wrong with Othello in this scene. But it is a kind of pious cruelty. Iago has maneuvered Othello to this point where he thinks he's going to redeem Desdemona's soul by killing her here. And indeed, in one of the many ironies of the play, on page 119, Shakespeare has Desdemona come back to life to do what? To lie. This is Act 5, Scene 2, line 121. We have thought she's dead. Othello thought she's dead. Line 121, a guiltless death I die. Oh, who hath done this deed? Nobody. I myself, farewell. Commend me to my kind lord. Oh, farewell. And this shows how persistent the Othello myth is in her mind. He has killed her, and she still believes in him. I mean, Shakespeare really takes this to the edge here, but I think it's deeply ingrained in this play how powerful the Othello myth is. And, you know, we discussed this in the section on Tuesday. This is, in legal terms, what's known as a dying declaration. A very strong hearsay rule in law, but one of the exceptions to the hearsay rule. In other words, you can't testify in court to what someone told you. That's hearsay. The prosecution has to put on the stand the person who tells it directly. So that person, of course, can be cross-examined and so on. That's why hearsay is generally inadmissible. But one way in which hearsay is admissible in court is what's called a dying declaration, where at least if it's reliably reported, it is assumed that people don't lie at the moment of their death. It is a long-standing principle of English common law that people don't lie at the moment of their death, and Desdemona does. And Othello can't let it go. I mean, this is the best news he's heard all day, that his victim is now saying he's innocent. Why? How should she be murdered? Alas, who knows? You heard her say herself it was not I. He's going to cop a plea here, get himself a cheap lawyer in Venice, and get off. Maybe hire Portia. She says so. I must needs report the truth, and Amelia's ready to report the dying declaration in court. Othello says she's like a liar gone to burning hell. 'Twas I that killed her. What a strange moment that is. But you see, in a weird way, this is the great soul man, and sort of like, alone I did it, like Coriolanus in that sense. But it is, man, I want her to go to hell, and I got her going now, because she lied in a dying moment, and that sends you to hell. Out comes the Hamlet in him. Again, these are extraordinary touches that Shakespeare supplies here. And in a way, no more extraordinary touch than Amelia's role in this final scene, where after accepting her husband and going along with his plans, she finally realizes there's nothing more important than the truth. And she speaks up at the risk of her own life to tell the truth about Iago here. And the ending, you know, it's the whole ending with Iago is kind of typical that top of page 126, Act 5, Scene 2, demand me nothing, so line 300, Act 5, Scene 2, demand me nothing, what you know from this time forth, I never will speak word. And Lodovico says, what not to pray? What an ironic moment that is, as if this was some deep need for Iago to pray here. And of course, Othello's death is one of the most moving scenes in all of drama. This last speech on 127, so Act 5, Scene 2, about line 353. Soft you, a word or two before you go. I have done the state some service, and they know it. No more of that. He realizes that all this public service he's done in Venice, it amounts to nothing. After all, they've already recalled him from Cyprus. We're actually 2 minutes from them seizing his wealth. I pray you in your letters, when you shall these lucky unlucky deeds relate, speak of me as I am, nothing extenuate, nor set down aught in malice. Then must you speak of one that loved not wisely, but too well, of one not easily jealous, being wrought, perplexed in the extreme. We discussed that in section on Tuesday, that easily jealous. I mean, in some sense, you want to say, my God, this is the most easily jealous man we've ever seen. Look at him, except this pile of lies about Desdemona. I've tried to show you, though, that Iago has to work very hard and very skillfully to get Othello to believe him. And in that sense, maybe he is not easily jealous. Of one whose hand, like the base Judean, threw a pearl away. This is, I think your notes point out, is a great textual crux. We do have two different texts of Othello. Don't vary as much as the different texts of King Lear and Hamlet, for example, but this is one of the famous points in one text. It's Judean. It's one text. It's Indian. You can see how in someone's handwriting, a textual compositor might mistake the one word for the other. Look at Judean and think it was Indian, or look at Indian and think it's Judean. What's interesting is either way it works. In either way, Othello is identifying himself with a foreigner here. A Judean, we all know how Jews are treated in Venice, and Indian would be either Indian from India or at this point, perhaps American Indian, that is someone from the New World. In any case, it is the sense here of a someone different from the main group, of one whose subdued eyes, albeit unused to the melting mood, drops tears as fast as the Arabian trees, their medicine will come. And then I think the greatest dying words in all of Shakespeare, set you down this, and say besides that in Aleppo once were a malignant and a turbaned Turk, beat a Venetian, introduced the state, I took by the throat the circumcised dog and smote him thus. All the complexity of Othello comes together in this one line. He is both the Venetian and the Turk in this moment. He's thinking back to a moment when he served Venice. Aleppo, by the way, was a very important commercial city. It was the western terminus of the Silk Road. It's in Syria today. I gather there's some beautiful, beautiful stuff in Aleppo. Let's hope it's not being totally destroyed. But in any case, it was a very important city. And much like Venice, it was, if you will, the Ottoman counterpart of Venice. People writing about it talk about the mixture of different races and different nations and different languages in the city. The English Levant Company, which Queen Elizabeth chartered in 1581 to trade with the Ottoman Turks, the English Levant Company was headquartered in Aleppo. So again, the Aleppo sounds very exotic to us. It would have had more of a ring for Shakespeare's audience than we might think, that they would have known people who were sending ships to Aleppo. But in any case, here it is. Othello once, in the service of Venice, killed a Turk, killed a foreigner, killed a barbarian, a non-Christian, and he'll do it again now. He will kill himself. And it's, you know, we saw Hamlet had so many scruples as a Christian in killing himself. Othello does not, because as a Christian, he kills the Turk in himself in the scene. That's the way he presents it. This is not a Christian killing a Christian. This is a Christian killing a Turk. And that's the way Othello gets out of the Christian suicide dilemma here. It is a very powerful concluding image for the tragedy of Othello here, as a man who tried to become an insider but always remained an outsider, and brings his life to an end here, brings his life to a tragedy in a way he has to survive at this point would turn the story into a comedy. It's true, actually, once he kills Desdemona, he ensures a tragic outcome. I mean, he's in a very difficult situation here in that he is genuinely ridiculous. He is believed a pack of lies, and an incredibly thin pack of lies. If the story came out short of Desdemona's death, he'd be the laughingstock of Venice. There's nothing to laugh at here when he brings about his tragedy. And again, very often Shakespeare's tragic heroes have to reassert their heroic status at the end precisely by acting tragically and bring the story to a close. So again, what we saw work out comically in The Merchant of Venice works out tragically here when we get a hero and a heroine who refuse to compromise and go all the way. So I'll stop there with Othello. And next Tuesday we will begin on Macbeth and see another story of a complex interaction between pagan heroism and Christian belief.